This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: The Art of Public Speaking by Dale Carnegie. Topic: Things to Think of First. The efficiency of a book is like that of a man in one important respect. Its attitude toward its subject is the first source of its power. A book may be full of good ideas well expressed, but if its writer views his subject from the wrong angle, even his excellent advice may prove to be ineffective. This book stands or falls by its author's attitude toward its subject. If the best way to teach oneself or others to speak effectively in public is to fill the mind with rules and to set up fixed standards for the interpretation of thought, the utterance of language, the making of gestures, and all the rest, then this book will be limited in value to such stray ideas throughout its pages as may prove helpful to the reader. As an effort to enforce a group of principles, it must be reckoned a failure because it is then untrue. It is of some importance, therefore, to those who take up this volume with open mind, that they should see clearly at the outset what is the thought that at once underlies and is builded through this structure. In plain words, it is this: training in public speaking is not a matter of externals, primarily. It is not a matter of imitation, fundamentally. It is not a matter of conformity to standards, at all. Public speaking is public utterance, public issuance of the man himself. Therefore, the first thing both in time and in importance is that the man should be and think and feel things that are worthy of being given forth. Unless there be something of value within, no tricks of training can ever make of the talker anything more than a machine, albeit a highly perfected machine, for the delivery of other men's goods. So self-development is fundamental in our plan. The second principle lies close to the first. The man must enthrone his will to rule over his thought, his feelings, and all his physical powers, so that the outer self may give perfect, unhampered expression to the inner. It is futile, we assert, to lay down systems of rules for voice culture, intonation, gesture, and whatnot, unless these two principles of having something to say and making the will sovereign have at least begun to make themselves felt in the life. The third principle will, we surmise, arouse no dispute. No one can learn how to speak who does not first speak as best he can. That may seem like a vicious circle in statement, but it will bear examination. Many teachers have begun with the how. Vain effort. It is an ancient truism that we learn to do by doing. The first thing for the beginner in public speaking is to speak, not to study voice and gesture and the rest. Once he has spoken, he can improve himself by self-observation or according to the criticisms of those who hear. But how shall he be able to criticize himself? Simply by finding out three things. What are the qualities which by common consent go to make up an effective speaker? By what means at least some of these qualities may be acquired? And what wrong habits of speech in himself work against his acquiring and using the qualities which he finds to be good? Experience, then, is not only the best teacher, but the first and the last. But experience must be a dual thing. The experience of others must be used to supplement, correct, and justify our own experience. In this way, we shall become our own best critics only after we have trained ourselves in self-knowledge, the knowledge of what other minds think, and in the ability to judge ourselves by the standards we have come to believe are right. If I ought, said Kant, I can. An examination of the contents of this volume will show how consistently these articles of faith have been declared, expounded, and illustrated. The student is urged to begin to speak at once of what he knows. Then he is given simple suggestions for self-control, with gradually increasing emphasis upon the power of the inner man over the outer. Next, the way to the rich storehouses of material is pointed out. And finally, all the while he is urged to speak, speak, speak as he is applying to his own methods, in his own personal way, the principles he has gathered from his own experience and observation and the recorded experiences of others. So now, at the very first, let it be as clear as light that methods are secondary matters, that the full mind, the warm heart, the dominant will are primary, and not only primary but paramount. For unless it be a full being that uses the methods, it will be like dressing a wooden image in the clothes of a man. Jayberg Essenwine, Narberth, PA. January 1, 1915. The Art of Public Speaking. Sense never fails to give them that habit, words enough to make them understood. It too often happens in some conversations, as in apothecary shops, that those pots that are empty or have things of small value in them are as gaudily dressed as those that are full of precious drugs. They that soar too high often fall hard, making a low and level dwelling preferable. The tallest trees are most in the power of the winds, and ambitious men of the blasts of fortune. Buildings have need of a good foundation, that lie so much exposed to the weather. William Penn. Chapter 1. Acquiring Confidence Before an Audience. There is a strange sensation, often experienced in the presence of an audience. It may proceed from the gaze of the many eyes that turn upon the speaker, especially if he permits himself to steadily return that gaze. Most speakers have been conscious of this in a nameless thrill, a real something pervading the atmosphere, tangible, evanescent, indescribable. All writers have borne testimony to the power of a speaker's eye in impressing an audience. This influence which we are now considering is the reverse of that picture, the power their eyes may exert upon him, especially before he begins to speak. After the inward fires of oratory are fanned into flame, the eyes of the audience lose all terror. William Pittenger, Extempore Speech. Students of public speaking continually ask, "How can I overcome self-consciousness and the fear that paralyzes me before an audience?" Did you ever notice, in looking from a train window, that some horses feed near the track, and never even pause to look up at the thundering cars, while just ahead at the next railroad crossing a farmer's wife will be nervously trying to quiet her scared horse as the train goes by? How would you cure a horse that is afraid of cars? Graze him in a backwoods lot where he would never see steam engines or automobiles, or drive or pasture him where he would frequently see the machines. Apply horse sense to ridding yourself of self-consciousness and fear. Face an audience as frequently as you can, and you will soon stop shying. You can never attain freedom from stage fright by reading a treatise. A book may give you excellent suggestions on how best to conduct yourself in the water, but sooner or later you must get wet, perhaps even strangle, and be half scared to death. There are a great many wetless bathing suits worn at the seashore, but no one ever learns to swim in them. To plunge is the only way. Practice, practice, practice in speaking before an audience will tend to remove all fear of audiences, just as practice in swimming will lead to confidence and facility in the water. You must learn to speak by speaking. The Apostle Paul tells us that every man must work out his own salvation. All we can do here is to offer you suggestions as to how best to prepare for your plunge. The real plunge no one can take for you. A doctor may prescribe, but you must take the medicine. Do not be disheartened if at first you suffer from stage fright. Dan Patch was more susceptible to suffering than a superannuated dray horse would be. It never hurts a fool to appear before an audience, for his capacity is not a capacity for feeling. A blow that would kill a civilized man soon heals on a savage. The higher we go in the scale of life, the greater is the capacity for suffering. For one reason or another, some master speakers never entirely overcome stage fright, but it will pay you to spare no pains to conquer it. Daniel Webster failed in his first appearance, and had to take his seat without finishing his speech because he was nervous. Gladstone was often troubled with self-consciousness in the beginning of an address. Beecher was always perturbed before talking in public. Blacksmiths sometimes twist a rope tight around the nose of a horse, and by thus inflicting a little pain, they distract his attention from the shoeing process. One way to get air out of a glass is to pour in water. Be absorbed by your subject. Apply the blacksmith's homely principle when you are speaking. If you feel deeply about your subject, you will be able to think of little else. Concentration is a process of distraction from less important matters. It is too late to think about the cut of your coat when once you are upon the platform, so center your interest on what you are about to say, Fill your mind with your speech material and, like the infilling water in the glass, it will drive out your unsubstantial fears. Self-consciousness is undue consciousness of self, and for the purpose of delivery, self is secondary to your subject, not only in the opinion of the audience, but, if you are wise, in your own. To hold any other view is to regard yourself as an exhibit instead of as a messenger with a message worth delivering. Do you remember Elbert Hubbard's tremendous little tract, A Message to Garcia? The youth subordinated himself to the message he bore. So must you, by all the determination you can muster. It is sheer egotism to fill your mind with thoughts of self when a greater thing is there, truth. Say this to yourself sternly and shame your self-consciousness into quiescence. If the theater caught fire, you could rush to the stage and shout directions to the audience without any self-consciousness, for the importance of what you were saying would drive all fear thoughts out of your mind. Far worse than self-consciousness through fear of doing poorly is self-consciousness through assumption of doing well. The first sign of greatness is when a man does not attempt to look and act great. Before you can call yourself a man at all, Kipling assures us, you must not look too good nor talk too wise. Nothing advertises itself so thoroughly as conceit. One may be so full of self as to be empty. Voltaire said we must conceal self-love. But that cannot be done. You know this to be true, for you have recognized overweening self-love in others. If you have it, others are seeing it in you. There are things in this world bigger than self, and in working for them, self will be forgotten, or, what is better, remembered only so as to help us win toward higher things. Have something to say. The trouble with many speakers is that they go before an audience with their minds a blank. It is no wonder that nature, abhorring a vacuum, fills them with the nearest thing handy, which generally happens to be, I wonder if I am doing this right. How does my hair look? I know I shall fail. Their prophetic souls are sure to be right. It is not enough to be absorbed by your subject. To acquire self-confidence, you must have something in which to be confident. If you go before an audience without any preparation or previous knowledge of your subject, you ought to be self-conscious. You ought to be ashamed to steal the time of your audience. Prepare yourself. Know what you are going to talk about, and in general, how you are going to say it. Have the first few sentences worked out completely, so that you may not be troubled in the beginning to find words. Know your subject better than your hearers know it, and you have nothing to fear. After preparing for success, expect it. Let your bearing be modestly confident, but most of all, be modestly confident within. Overconfidence is bad, but to tolerate premonitions of failure is worse, for a bold man may win attention by his very bearing, while a rabbit-hearted coward invites disaster. Humility is not the personal discount that we must offer in the presence of others. Against this old interpretation, there has been a most healthy modern reaction. True humility, any man who thoroughly knows himself must feel, but it is not a humility that assumes a worm-like meekness. It is rather a strong, vibrant prayer for greater power for service, a prayer that Uriah Heep could never have uttered. Washington Irving once introduced Charles Dickens at a dinner given in the latter's honor. In the middle of his speech, Irving hesitated, became embarrassed, and sat down awkwardly. Turning to a friend beside him, he remarked, "There, I told you I would fail, and I did." If you believe you will fail, there is no hope for you. You will. Rid yourself of this "I am a poor worm in the dust" idea. You are a God, with infinite capabilities. All things are ready, if the mind be so. The eagle looks the cloudless sun in the face. Assume mastery over your audience. In public speech, as in electricity, there is a positive and a negative force. Either you or your audience are going to possess the positive factor. If you assume it, you can almost invariably make it yours. If you assume the negative, you are sure to be negative. Assuming a virtue or a vice vitalizes it. Summon all your power of self-direction, And remember that though your audience is infinitely more important than you, the truth is more important than both of you, because it is eternal. If your mind falters in its leadership, the sword will drop from your hands. Your assumption of being able to instruct or lead or inspire a multitude or even a small group of people may appall you as being colossal impudence, as indeed it may be, but having once essayed to speak, be courageous. Be courageous, it lies within you to be what you will. Make yourself be calm and confident. Reflect that your audience will not hurt you. If Beecher in Liverpool had spoken behind a wire screen, he would have invited the audience to throw the overripe missiles with which they were loaded. But he was a man, confronted his hostile hearers fearlessly, and won them. In facing your audience, pause a moment and look them over. 100 chances to 1 they want you to succeed, for what man is so foolish as to spend his time, perhaps his money, in the hope that you will waste his investment by talking dully? Concluding hints. Do not make haste to begin. Haste shows lack of control. Do not apologize. It ought not to be necessary, and if it is, it will not help. Go straight ahead. Take a deep breath, relax, and begin in a quiet conversational tone as though you were speaking to one large friend. You will not find it half so bad as you imagined. Really, it is like taking a cold plunge. After you are in, the water is fine. In fact, having spoken a few times, you will even anticipate the plunge with exhilaration. To stand before an audience and make them think your thoughts after you is one of the greatest pleasures you can ever know. Instead of fearing it, you ought to be as anxious as the foxhounds straining at their leashes or the racehorses tugging at their reins. So cast out fear, for fear is cowardly when it is not mastered. The bravest know fear, but they do not yield to it. Face your audience pluckily. If your knees quake, make them stop. In your audience lies some victory for you and the cause you represent. Go win it. Suppose Charles Martel had been afraid to hammer the Saracen at Tours. Suppose Columbus had feared to venture out into the unknown West. Suppose our forefathers had been too timid to oppose the tyranny of George III. Suppose that any man who ever did anything worthwhile had been a coward. The world owes its progress to the men who have dared, and you must dare to speak the effective word that is in your heart to speak, for often it requires courage to utter a single sentence. But remember that men erect no monuments and weave no laurels for those who fear to do what they can. Is all this unsympathetic, do you say? Man, what you need is not sympathy, but a push. No one doubts that temperament and nerves and illness and even praiseworthy modesty may, singly or combined, cause the speaker's cheek to blanch before an audience. But neither can anyone doubt that coddling will magnify this weakness. The victory lies in a fearless frame of mind. Professor Walter Dill Scott says, "Success or failure in business is caused more by mental attitude even than by mental capacity." Banish the fear attitude. Acquire the confident attitude. And remember that the only way to acquire it is to acquire it. In this foundation chapter, we have tried to strike the tone of much that is to follow. Many of these ideas will be amplified and enforced in a more specific way. But through all these chapters on an art which Mr. Gladstone believed to be more powerful than the public press, the note of justifiable self-confidence must sound again and again. Questions and exercises. 1. What is the cause of self-consciousness? 2. Why are animals free from it? 3. What is your observation regarding self-consciousness in children? 4. Why are you free from it under the stress of unusual excitement? 5. How does moderate excitement affect you? 6. What are the 2 fundamental requisites for the acquiring of self-confidence? Which is the more important? 7. What effect does confidence on the part of the speaker have on the audience? 8. Write out a 2-minute speech on confidence and cowardice. 9. What effect do habits of thought have on confidence? In this connection, read the chapter on right thinking and personality. 10. Write out very briefly any experience you may have had involving the teachings of this chapter. 11. Give a 3-minute talk on stage fright, including a kindly imitation of two or more victims. Chapter 2: The Sin of Monotony. One day ennui was born from uniformity, mot. Our English has changed with the years, so that many words now connote more than they did originally. This is true of the word monotonous. From having but one tone, it has come to mean more broadly lack of variation. The monotonous speaker not only drones along in the same volume and pitch of tone, but uses always the same emphasis, the same speed, the same thoughts, or dispenses with thought altogether. Monotony, the cardinal and most common sin of the public speaker, is not a transgression, it is rather a sin of omission, for it consists in living up to the confession of the prayer book, "We have left undone those things we ought to have done." Emerson says, "The virtue of art lies in detachment, in sequestering one object from the embarrassing variety." That is just what the monotonous speaker fails to do. He does not detach one thought or phrase from another, they are all expressed in the same manner. To tell you that your speech is monotonous may mean very little to you, so let us look at the nature and the curse of monotony in other spheres of life. Then we shall appreciate more fully how it will blight an otherwise good speech. If the Victrola in the adjoining apartment grinds out just 3 selections over and over again, it is pretty safe to assume that your neighbor has no other records. If a speaker uses only a few of his powers, it points very plainly to the fact that the rest of his powers are not developed. Monotony reveals our limitations. In its effect on its victim, monotony is actually deadly. It will drive the bloom from the cheek and the luster from the eye as quickly as sin, and often leads to viciousness. The worst punishment that human ingenuity has ever been able to invent is extreme monotony, solitary confinement. Lay a marble on the table and do nothing 18 hours of the day, but change that marble from one point to another and back again, and you will go insane if you continue long enough. So this thing that shortens life and is used as the most cruel of punishments in our prisons is the thing that will destroy all the life and force of a speech. Avoid it as you would shun a deadly dull bore. The idle rich can have 6 homes, command all the varieties of foods gathered from the 4 corners of the earth, and sail for Africa or Alaska at their pleasure. But the poverty-stricken man must walk or take a streetcar. He does not have the choice of yacht, auto, or special train. He must spend the most of his life in labor and be content with the staples of the food market. Monotony is poverty, whether in speech or in life. Strive to increase the variety of your speech as the businessman labors to augment his wealth. Birdsongs, forest glens, and mountains are not monotonous. It is the long rows of brownstone fronts and the miles of paved streets that are so terribly same. Nature in her wealth gives us endless variety. Man with his limitations is often monotonous. Get back to nature in your methods of speech-making. The power of variety lies in its pleasure-giving quality. The great truths of the world have often been couched in fascinating stories, Les Miserables, for instance. If you wish to teach or influence men, you must please them, first or last. Strike the same note on the piano over and over again. This will give you some idea of the displeasing, jarring effect monotony has on the ear. The dictionary defines monotonous as being synonymous with wearisome. That is putting it mildly. It is maddening. The department store prince does not disgust the public by playing only the one tune, "Come Buy My Wares." He gives recitals on a $125,000 organ, and the pleased people naturally slip into a buying mood. How to conquer monotony? We obviate monotony in dress by replenishing our wardrobes. We avoid monotony in speech by multiplying our powers of speech. We multiply our powers of speech by increasing our tools. The carpenter has special implements with which to construct the several parts of a building. The organist has certain keys and stops, which he manipulates to produce his harmonies and effects. In like manner, the speaker has certain instruments and tools at his command by which he builds his argument, plays on the feelings, and guides the beliefs of his audience. To give you a conception of these instruments and practical help in learning to use them are the purposes of the immediately following chapters. Why did not the children of Israel whirl through the desert in limousines? And why did not Noah have moving picture entertainments and talking machines on the ark? The laws that enable us to operate an automobile, produce moving pictures or music on the Victrola, would have worked just as well then as they do today. It was ignorance of law that for ages deprived humanity of our modern conveniences. Many speakers still use ox cart methods in their speech, instead of employing automobile or overland express methods. They are ignorant of laws that make for efficiency in speaking. Just to the extent that you regard and use the laws that we are about to examine and learn how to use, will you have efficiency and force in your speaking? And just to the extent that you disregard them, will your speaking be feeble and ineffective? We cannot impress too thoroughly upon you the necessity for a real working mastery of these principles. They are the very foundations of successful speaking. Get your principles right, said Napoleon, and the rest is a matter of detail. It is useless to shoe a dead horse, and all the sound principles in Christendom will never make a live speech out of a dead one. So let it be understood that public speaking is not a matter of mastering a few dead rules. The most important law of public speech is the necessity for truth, force, feeling, and life. Forget all else but not this. When you have mastered the mechanics of speech, outlined in the next few chapters, you will no longer be troubled with monotony. The complete knowledge of these principles, and the ability to apply them, will give you great variety in your powers of expression. But they cannot be mastered and applied by thinking or reading about them. You must practice, practice, practice. If no one else will listen to you, listen to yourself. You must always be your own best critic and the severest one of all. The technical principles that we lay down in the following chapters are not arbitrary creations of our own. They are all founded on the practices that good speakers and actors adopt, either naturally and unconsciously or under instruction, in getting their effects. It is useless to warn the student that he must be natural. To be natural may be to be monotonous. The little strawberry up in the Arctics with a few tiny seeds and an acid tang is a natural berry, but it is not to be compared with the improved variety that we enjoy here. The dwarfed oak on the rocky hillside is natural, but a poor thing compared with the beautiful tree found in the rich, moist bottomlands. Be natural, but improve your natural gifts until you have approached the ideal, for we must strive after idealized nature in fruit, tree, and speech. Questions and exercises. 1. What are the causes of monotony? 2. Cite some instances in nature. 3. Cite instances in man's daily life. 4. Describe some of the effects of monotony in both cases. 5. Read aloud some speech without paying particular attention to its meaning or force. 6. Now repeat it after you have thoroughly assimilated its matter and spirit. What difference do you notice in its rendition? 7. Why is monotony one of the worst, as well as one of the most common faults of speakers? Chapter 3. Efficiency through emphasis and subordination. In a word, the principle of emphasis is followed best not by remembering particular rules, but by being full of a particular feeling. C.S. Baldwin, Writing and Speaking. The gun that scatters too much does not bag the birds. The same principle applies to speech. The speaker that fires his force and emphasis at random into a sentence will not get results. Not every word is of special importance, therefore only certain words demand emphasis. You say Massachusetts and Minneapolis. You do not emphasize each syllable alike, but hit the accented syllable with force and hurry over the unimportant ones. Now, why do you not apply this principle in speaking a sentence? To some extent you do in ordinary speech, but do you in public discourse? It is there that monotony, caused by lack of emphasis, is so painfully apparent.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.